Guys, welcome back to the channel. If you're new, don't forget to subscribe and follow me on Twitter at SuperHypeDC. The link to my profile is always in the description. I also have I just started designing some merchandise. So if you're interested in taking a look at that, go ahead and follow the link in the description. And you should probably see the little cards somewhere here on the video. You can get to it that way as well. Yesterday I had the awesome experience of doing my first interview with someone in the film industry, Fabian Wagner. Amazing cinematographer for Zack Snyder's Justice League and also other projects such as Game of Thrones, Sherlock. So that was such an amazing experience that I'm so thankful to have been a part of. So enjoy the video, enjoy the interview. Sorry for some of the editing issues. There was a part where Fabian's feed was kind of lagging. So I kind of tried to edit that out as best as I could. But I hope you enjoy the video and thanks for watching, guys. Don't forget to leave a thumbs up and we'll see you next time.
And joining us right now is also a friend of mine, Ali Brooks. And Fabian, one thing about Ali Brooks, when I was on a show on Tuesday, the thing the guys was talking about, and I'm not, you're probably going to see a soon, and she knows where I'm going with this. There's actually a video of Miss Brooks. She's actually squatting 200 pounds on her back. Wow. And us guys, I mean, we're not talking about we're amazed that she was doing that. So Ali, please tell us what made you do that? Jesus.
I can't believe that's the first thing you brought up. Well, over the past almost 2 years now, I've gotten into weightlifting. By the way, it's awesome to meet you, Fabian. I was not prepared until like 4 hours later to do this.
But,
I'm kind of jittery right now.
This is my fault, I think.
It's okay. We're all on different time zones. So, it's okay. It's totally okay. So I'm a little jittery right now because I was like scrambling to get everything.
You were lifting weights up to a minute ago.
I was cleaning actually, which is like a workout in itself. But it's awesome to meet you. It's so cool. So we're squatting. Yes. Okay. I got into it and then just over time, I have preferred it over just, I mean, I do normal workouts too, but didn't realize that I was going to like weightlifting. And so I've enjoyed just trying to get stronger. And so recently, like my Instagram page, I don't really do much of my channel on there, but it's more of a personal page where I had decided to start recording workouts and recording, you know, to kind of track my progress and stuff like that. And recently I started sharing some of them on Twitter, and apparently it's become a point of discussion now, which I didn't know until Luis and I were talking the other night to prepare for this. So it's kind of funny that was brought up, but yeah, it's just, I enjoy recording it and sharing it. And apparently other people are talking about it, which I didn't know, but it's kind of funny.
I can't even do 100, let alone 200 because of my back. But I already asked Fabian a couple of questions. So okay, I'm gonna have you ask Fabian your question as well.
Okay, well, forgive me if I repeat anything that was mentioned because I don't know what you discussed yet. But just so we can kind of all get an understanding, for viewers as well, since you're a cinematographer, director of photography, what exactly is your main role when it comes to filmmaking? What is your main objective when you are involved in a film?
Well, I mean, the main objective would always be just to have some fun, you know. That would be the main objective. Obviously, this is such an awesome job. I'm so lucky to be doing this job. So it's a job where you can actually, even though it can be very stressful at times, it can be very, you know, long hours, it can be very tough work. It's something that you can always enjoy, which is just amazing, you know. But the main objectives would obviously be, you know, joking aside, you know, you as a cinematographer, you're there to visualize the director's visions, whatever he or she has in their heads. You're there to help making that into moving images. So, you know, it's very creative, it's very collaborative, it's very, you know, it's just great fun. You know, you get to see a lot of different places, get to meet a lot of different people, work with actors, which is something I love. I love actors. I love working with actors. So, and, you know, you get to tell some awesome stories sometimes. So,
awesome. That's cool. Thank you for sharing that with us. Luis, can you give me a little bit of a summary of like what you've discussed already?
Well, he told us what he was raised and what made him get into this business. I only asked him two questions. So you just came on like a couple of minutes when we were really talking. So you have an impeccable timing.
Oh, okay. Oh, am I unmuted now?
No. Sure.
Okay. Okay, awesome. I wasn't sure how long you had been talking yet. So, all right. So I would like to know, how did you first feel when you first found out that the Snyder Cut was actually going to be released for everyone to see? What was like the first thing that came to your mind? Because we know you've shared a lot. You've been a big supporter of the Snyder Cut movement. You've shared a lot on social media. And I think fans definitely appreciate that it wasn't just us fans supporting it and calling for it, but people like you and Clay Enos and Jay Oliva, who were also big supporters of it. So I could imagine that it would be even more emotional for people who worked on it to find out.
Yeah, I mean, look, it's such a multi-layered thing. I mean, obviously, you know, I mean, first of all, it's something that's never happened in the history of film before, right?
Right.
It's never happened that you had any film, I guess, that then was completely redone. I mean, obviously we know that there's director's cuts and stuff, but not to a scale like that's been happening with the Snyder Cut. So, you know, the movie that we all saw wasn't the movie that I expected to see when we initially shot the film and I worked with Zach. So obviously that was a disappointing thing. I'm not gonna make anyone bad because it's just what happened. That's just the way it is, you know, and there's many different factors that play into that. But it wasn't the movie I expected. That was, for me, that was the reason why I was sad that I didn't get to see the movie that I was working on for so long. And I had such an amazing time doing it as well. Like I think everybody knows, I've always been saying that. So you know, the fact that we are gonna see the Snyder Cut and that we're gonna get to see Zack's vision is incredible. You know,
yeah,
it's absolutely amazing, and I can't believe it. And the most amazing thing is it's something that has purely been born out of the dedication of the fans. And, you know, that is something that's also been unique, and that's also been, no one's ever heard of that before, that the fans can create such a huge movement to generate the Snyder Cut. So that's, you know, that's incredible. I think that's the reason why a lot of other people and me support, you know, not only do we support the Snyder Cut because Zach is, you know, an awesome person and an amazing director and just one of the best guys you could ever imagine, but also because, you know, it's the film that we all worked on. And, you know, so that's the one side, obviously, which is just like, you know, feeling kind of really joyful because we can see the film that we did shoot and we were working on for so long. Obviously, on the other hand, it's more of a bitter feeling because we all know why it all happened and why Zach had to leave the movie, because obviously, unfortunately, his daughter passed away, and that was a really tragic incident and a horrible thing to happen to anyone. And so it's always something that's, you know, in the back of your head. And there's also been, of course, you know, some really positive things have come out of it. And, you know, for suicide prevention and making people more aware of, you know, how people feel, and how people close to us feel, and we don't know about it. So it's a thing that's also very close to my heart. It's happened to a couple of friends of mine, and it was very horrible to see it happen to Zach. So, you know, it's this whole thing has got all emotions, I think, in it, which makes it even more amazing that it's all happening and coming out. So,
Fabian, when did you actually find out that there was a such thing as a Snyder Cut movement? When did you find out from somebody? When did you know that the fans were fighting for that cut?
Well, I think it was pretty early on. You know, you could see what the fans were feeling about the theatrical version came out in 2017, and sort of people didn't let it go for a long, long time. And so you would always be reminded of that. Oh. You know, they're still not happy about the theatrical cut. You know, they're still talking about let's get a Snyder cut. And then suddenly, obviously, this whole movement came along. You know, I can't quite remember when that was. It was probably early 2019 or something. I can't remember when it actually became like a real movement thing. But I obviously saw it pretty early on and supported it straight away.
Right. So when you actually, because I know there's some quotes out there. I believe you said when you saw the Justice League, like your heart dropped. You was heartbroken because a lot of your hard work that you put into it, you didn't see on there. I'm not as smart as, you know, as I don't have a Yale degree or to have a Stanford degree, but me personally, I know that
if
I
work hard.
Yeah, well, you know, sometimes people could have all those degrees, but what they don't have is common sense. And unfortunately, you know, that's what's missing. But I know as a human being, if I would have worked hard on something and really dedicated my life into it and have to have someone else just redid the work, not because of my work was bad, but because of the other stuff, the other, you know, and I'm not going to get into it, but all the politics, to me, that makes it more harder. To me, it's easier for someone to say, hey, Fabian, you know, we're going to go different directions because, you know, we need this, we need that. So you could go and improve on what, you know, any constructive criticism that you get, but to have it done the way that they did it. I mean, if it would have been me, I would have been hurt and upset. I mean, is that how you felt, or in the business you have to move on?
Well, you know, in the end, I mean, look, I think I said that I couldn't see much because I was crying all the way through. You know, that's a bit of a, you know, very that's a little bit over the top. But obviously, I was upset. You know, I loved working with Zach. Zach is an incredible director. He's super talented. He's super visual. We had a great time, and I knew all the stuff that we shot, and I knew how we were making the stuff look. I knew how I was shooting it. I knew, you know, if you look at the first three trailers that came out for Justice League in 2016, they were the trailers that Zach edited, that Zach recolor graded, and you can really see the style and the look of that movie that I was going for, that we were going for back then. And it was totally different. Those three trailers looked totally different to the film that we eventually saw. So that's obviously very sad. And, you know, you kind of never get over that in a way. But then, you know, on the other hand, it's a movie and you're there. You're employed by the studio to make a movie. And in the end, they can do with that movie whatever they want to do. So it's not, you know, it's not, there's nothing much I can do. And, you know, I've got to do other things, you know. So obviously it would upset you and you would be annoyed about it, but, you know, you'd have to kind of move on and do other stuff. You know, I had, even back then, you know, I had a difficult couple of years because my mom passed away during the time. So when something like that happens, you don't think about that movie anymore. You think about your family, you know. In Zach's case, it was even worse because his daughter passed away. So he didn't think about anything else but his family. Of course, it upset him that his movie wasn't the movie that he wanted to make, but other things became way more important.
Go ahead, Ali.
Yeah, I agree. I think that one part of why the release of Snyder Cut movement just kept gaining momentum was because it became bigger than just the movie. Like you had mentioned earlier, how, you know, the AFSP and all of that, and a lot of us share the links and, you know, the products that are, that people are able to buy to donate to that. And I think Zach has shown a lot of appreciation
for the course, huge. Yeah,
you can tell that he's very and feels very appreciative to the fans, which is why I think part of one of the reasons why he's been hopping on, you know, YouTubers' streams and stuff like that, and not just these big media outlets, but he's giving attention to the fans, because I think more than just having this huge movement for his movie to come out, I know he appreciates that, but I think it's special to him that it has raised awareness for this bigger thing, you know, and that it's personal for him. And I think it's just really cool to see how this movement has changed over the past couple of years. And like,
which is why this makes the DC fans even more special. Just this whole thing, you know, is pretty incredible.
I'm not a little something personal about myself. The reason I got involved, and I'm just one of many, the millions of people out, you know, out there who fought for the cut. But to me, Fabian, it was more personal to me because at the age of, it was 93, so I would have been 19, I tried to commit suicide. I felt depressed. I felt my parents had just broken up. And you know, I wasn't doing well in school. I was being bullied, you know, in high school. So there was a lot of things that I was going through emotionally, and depression to me is the silent killer, you know, feeling alone. And that's how I felt. So when I heard about what happened with Zach's daughter, it broke my heart, you know, cause I have two girls, and I cannot fathom the pain that both Deborah and Zach was going through. But what really got me angry, and I don't expect you to answer, I'm just telling you from my point of view, is I don't know Zach, but I do know what's written about him. And I know Zach is not a quitter. I know when he starts something, he finishes it. So I already knew something was up when they put out a press saying that that stepped away. In my mind, I'm saying to myself, he's not a quitter, you know. And you know, I did my digging, but that's what got me into the movie, because of how they treated that man. He gave 7 years of his life, and to use his daughter as an excuse, you know, for the public, that really hurt me. So that's why I joined the movement. And to me, it was something more personal. Say, hey, again, I think, you know, I'm a common sense person. It's okay if the studio wants to move on. It's fine. I mean, everybody moves on, but at least allow the man to finish what he started. So it not only it impacted him, but it impacted the cast, the crews, yourself, for them taking a different directions and then misleading the public. And so to me, that's why it made me stronger to support, not only support Zach, but to support the suicide prevention, because I lived it. I know what Autumn was going through. And there are a lot of people out there who has these kind of thoughts that they don't speak up. So I'm happy that this movement gave the suicide prevention a face. Because now people are not afraid to speak up. Now people are not afraid to go seek help. You know, you don't have to be embarrassed to say, hey, I feel down today. I need some help. You know, and to empower those kind of people, you're okay. I'm here with you. And, you know, so that's why I joined the movement. Obviously, because I'm a DC fan, but it really, really impacted me. So that's why I wanted to tell you as a fan, the reason why I got involved, because it really hit home to me. It really hit home to me. It broke my heart to see that man, what he went through. And what impressed me about Zach is that he never, ever said one negative thing. That he's a better man than me. Because if it would have been me, I'm telling you, because I would have spoke up. And I know he knew what was going on. I mean, Deborah was still attacked, you know, attached to the project. So he must have known what was going on. So anyway, so when you seen the people, especially the suicide prevention, doesn't it make you feel like, wow, I'm part of something special, not just a movie, but a movement like helping others?
Yeah, of course. I mean, it's, you know, it's always good to help others. It's always, it's like my wife always says, it's nice to be nice, and it doesn't cost you anything. I think that's one of the most important things. But to be honest, I've never thought about it that way. You know, to me, it was just always clear that, you know, to obviously be supportive to Zach and to be supportive to anyone who needs it. And, you know, having seen, you know, the love that people have for Zack Snyder, and having seen the love that people, his fans have for his films, to, you know, if I can talk about it for an hour, you know, a few times, you know, that's nothing. That's, you know, of course you would do that without even thinking about it. So I've never really thought about it, you know. I'm just glad that it's all happened this way, and that all these movements have taken off like they have.
Go ahead, Ali.
Yeah, I think that's one thing that's been really consistent with all of the artists like yourself who have been involved with making the movie. I guess on a professional level, you probably wouldn't anyway, but, you know, not saying anything negative towards the studio or, you know, Joss Whedon or anyone that was, you know, kind of had taken over the project at the time. It's just been support for the fact that you guys made a certain movie. Us fans believed we were getting a certain movie, and then it didn't happen. And so I think that's another reason why all of us have like pushed so hard to see it, was because all of the stuff that we were shown in the trailers, like you were talking about earlier, I never understood when people were saying there's no way it could exist when all you have to do is watch the trailers. That's how I thought about it, was, you know, and then all this, I mean, beautiful imagery that we've seen from people like yourself, and, you know, we know that we didn't get that when we watched it in theaters. You know, immediately when we left, we were like, that's not what we saw. And where was this? And where was that? And, you know, the fact that you guys have all been so supportive, and everyone that has worked with Zach that has done interviews like this or has made statements about it, and even the cast, you know, it just seems like there's a family on set when you guys are shooting the movies with Zach, and just the environment that is created when you, like, I don't understand, like, that shows in the movie itself also, you know, like, that comes through. And it just, I think I think this is the most, like, a fandom has ever actually known about all the people behind the scenes that have, you know, I don't think in the past, unless you were maybe like going to film school or something like that, but just as a general fandom, I don't know how many of us have been as familiar with all these different components of, you know, the film besides the director. And I think that it's cool that, like, you know, we've been able to have more appreciation for the cinematographers and, you know, all these other people, the stunt teams, and, you know, it's just expanded so much. And
yeah, it's a very good point. Awesome.
Besides, you know, of course we know Zack Snyder, but, like, it's gone beyond that now. And you know, having people like you that were like, wow, this is so awesome that we, you know, we get to appreciate your side of it and what you bring to the table, you know, and that it's, you know, the director, yes, you guys are bringing his vision to life, but you have your own role in that. And see all of you guys being so supportive of it, it makes sense because it's your work too. And, you know, like, I don't think it was over the top that you were crying while watching the movie, because that would be devastating to see your work, you know, not coming through. I think some of us probably have cried about it too.
I think you would cry.
It's not even our work.
Ali, I think you would cry. I mean, you're crying for a trailer. So if you're crying for a trailer,
I did cry. I did cry when the Snyder Cut teaser came out, because it's just been an emotional, like I said, if it's been emotional for the fans this whole time that have been involved, it's just a surreal thing, because, like you said, it hasn't happened before, not to this extent, maybe a director's cut, but not a completely different version. And, Now we're getting even more than what we thought we would get if it ever happened. So I don't think it's over the top that you cried, because
no,
you and it's your own, it's your work. It's not just what you want to see as a fan.
Absolutely. I don't think
that's over the top. But are there any anticipated, do you have any like most anticipated moments to see that were not in the theatrical version?
No, Zach is a very unique filmmaker. He's a very visionary filmmaker, as we all know. I mean, I've always been a fan of his work since 300, really. And so, you know, to know just the fact, you know, I don't know how Zach's going to cut this. I haven't seen much of it yet. You know, I've seen a few bits and we've spoken a few times, but I haven't seen it yet. But I know that he's going to cut it in his way. He's going to do the Zack Snyder things that we all love, you know, and just to know that is making me excited. So there isn't really anything in particular that I can't wait to see. It's, you know, really just to be seeing the way that he's always wanted to make this.
Tony has a question for Fabian. What movie do you feel did your best work on, or should I say you were the happiest with? So that's a question from Tony.
Hi, Tony. It's a good question. Hopefully my next one.
Is that how you think about it? Like, you know, okay, this one's cool, but I hope to always do better on the next one.
Well, you know, I'm very self-critical, and I like to, you know, it's a big learning process. I've still got a lot to learn. So, you know, I'm very grateful for the things I've been a part of. You know, I've been very grateful to be part of such big shows like Game of Thrones or Justice League or Sherlock and things, you know. I think the things that I'm most proud of are probably, you know, things from very early on in my career, like things where we had no money, you know, where our budget was $100 and we built everything. We built the set together. It was just a few friends, and we built the set and we made everything ourselves. We had no money and it looked like it was $10,000 or more. That's the things you're kind of most proud of, because they are the most creative and they're the most fun. And
just to give you a background, what I was doing when this Snyder Cut actually was announced, I was driving. I was driving towards my therapy, and I was hearing the commentary for the Man of Steel. And when he officially announced it, I screamed so loud in my SUV that people literally were driving by the end of 2017, 2018, fighting for this cut. And to be told that it's never going to happen, to be told that no phone campaign, no letter campaign, no tweeting is going to change that. To be told, you know, to there was a hit piece on a Wall Street Journal. I'm pretty sure you know about that. That it does not exist. And yet we kept on fighting, and it actually made the movement even bigger. So I felt the relief, not for me, but for Zach, for you, for everyone who worked so hard in that. So now the public, we get to see your work. I was relieved, and it really shows me, and I had a couple of YouTubers on my show. It shows me what the human mind could do when we put our minds together and focus on one goal. If the human race just could put our minds together, forget about all those things and focus on the good, we could get a lot accomplished. I mean, what do you think?
Yeah. I mean, it's true. You know, like I said, this is something that's never happened before. So yes, I totally agree. You know, but there's a lot of things I have to sort of play in with that. And, you know, this happened at the right time.
Yes.
You know, this might have not happened with every filmmaker. You know, Zach was the right person to also do that with. You know, there's a lot of things that sort of play together in this. But yes, you're right. You know, when everybody pulls together and does the same thing, then things can happen. So that's a great thing.
Here's a question that I want to ask you. Who is, out of the Justice League cast, who is the biggest prankster?
Well, they're all pretty funny. They all like to play a prank, but it probably would have to be between. I mean, Jason is always up for a bit of fun, and Ezra, obviously.
Yeah.
You know, those two are probably on the top, but they're all up for a bit of fun.
Go ahead, Ali.
I have a question about your personal style as a cinematographer. So in Man of Steel and BVS, I mean, all of these movies, well, Zach in general, he has this beautiful, like, you just know a Zach shot when you see it, you know a Zach movie when you see it. He has this like signature, like he has beautiful shots in his movies and color, and you know, it's very significant. But how does your personal style differ from like the cinematography we saw in Man of Steel and BVS, even though those movies also had beautiful imagery? How would you say you brought something different from those movies when working on Justice League, which I guess we'll know more in detail when we see it, because we haven't seen it yet. But just from what we have been able to see a little bit in previous trailers or like now in the teaser, how would you say you maybe have your, what was different?
Great question, Ali.
Yeah, that's a very good question. I mean, look, you know.
By the way, I'm sorry. That was from a Twitter question. So, yeah. It was my personal question, but it was a good question. They wanted me to ask you, so.
I mean, first of all, you know, one of the amazing things about this job is that every job is different. And even if you do two films of the same genre, you still might approach them in a completely different way, so they're still totally different. So that's, you know, so your work is never the same. So that's one of the things I love the most about it. The reason why those films, you know, I mean, Man of Steel was different to BVS, and this would be different to BVS and Man of Steel. But hopefully, what we try to do, and what I certainly try to do, was that it can live in the same universe, it can live in the same family, but it's a different beast, you know. And so Zach was very clear about that. He wanted this to be slightly more colorful than BVS, for example. You know, there are certain things that he wanted this to be different with. You know, this was something new. And so, you know, he wanted to make it different for whatever creative reason, but also for his own reasons, because, you know, you don't want to repeat yourself. You don't want to always do the same thing. So, you know, you come up with new reasons why this should need to be different, why this should be different. And that's, you know, that's one of the very challenging things and one of the great things. So hopefully we managed to make it part of the family of those movies, but it has its own look and it has its own style. And, you know, I think the wish and the of any cinematographer would be to create that and then be able to put your own sort of little stamp onto it. To be honest, I don't actually know what my stamp is. I think hopefully I have one. I've been told by people that when they see some stuff, they sometimes think, oh, this could be Fabian maybe, which is very, very nice. I always find that very, very nice. And I'm very grateful for that, and hopefully that's true. But you know, it's more of a, it's not something that I consciously do. It's something that's very subconsciously. It's something that you strive for. You know, I love, for example, there's only things that I love visually. I love silhouettes. I love reflections. I love certain elements. And then so you, whatever you do, you kind of subconsciously, I guess, put them into the things you shoot, and that then, if that all works together, that kind of becomes your style, hopefully. So,
yeah, follow up, Ali?
Yeah, I think that's a good point, because I think with anyone who's, you know, considers themselves a creative person, I think that kind of just happens. Like, if you try to think too hard about, you know, of course, you might have an idea in your head of how you want it to look, but then if you try to overthink it, I think it's more the subconscious that probably comes through, and then it kind of just, like you said, starts becoming your personal.
Well, there's a subconscious element and there's a conscious element. Obviously, right. Now, if you're doing a period piece, if you're doing a period drama, something that's set in the 70s, let's say, which is a very distinctive period, you know, there's very conscious things that you do from a color perspective, for example, to push that movie into the 70s so that when you see it, immediately people will go, this is the 70s, right? And you do that with costumes, with color, with composition, whatever. So those are very, very conscious things that you do. But then there's a lot of stuff is happening on an unconscious level that you don't really think about it, you know, on the forefront of your head. It's things, like I said, it's things that you like visually that you then try and put into those images, once they're all together, hopefully that will work. So,
yeah, and I think it makes sense also what you were saying about Man of Steel BVS, Justice League. Like we're going to be able to know, we're going to tell that when we watch Zack Snyder's Justice League, that it exists within the same family of Man of Steel and BVS, but it's still going to have its own little elements that are different. So I think that's a good way to explain that.
Fabian, when you were shooting Justice League, did you speak with Larry Fong to get to know Zack Snyder? What, you know, what was he looking for? You know, what he likes, what he doesn't like. Did you get to talk to him?
Well, I mean, I knew Larry before Justice League, you know, and I've always been a big fan of Larry. So I never spoke to Larry about Zach because I generally never talk to other people about people, because you're always going to get a certain impression of someone, which is never going to be your own impression because every person is different, right? So,
correct.
Mm-hmm. So what's the point? But I knew Larry, and obviously, you know, I know that they're great friends, and Larry's been shooting most of Zach's stuff, so I was very fortunate to be able to do this film with Zach, because normally obviously Larry would have done it. So and we spoke. I spoke to Larry on numerous occasions before and after, but never about those kind of things.
Did you look at his work, like in BVS, and say, oh, that's a good shot, maybe I could do it this way? I mean, is that something that you guys do when you guys are studying a movie? Or, you know, or a director, do you guys do that?
Probably people, you know, people are different. Some people do that. I certainly don't do it that way. I mean, obviously, I watch BBS, and I've seen all of Larry's films, and I love all of Larry's films. I think Larry's one of the best cinematographers out there. But I didn't look at it and think like, oh, I need to do that and copy that for Justice League.
Okay.
But were there things from Man of Steel and BVS that you were kind of inspired by to make it feel like it was in the same family, like you said, but not copy?
No, I mean, yeah, but
like things that are, you know, that should be, like you said,
It's the overall picture. It's the overall, mm-hmm. overall way they look. I mean, you know, you can split those movies into frame grabs of each shot, and it's a beautiful. Every image is beautiful, right? So, you know, so there's a lot of images that inspire you. Just like, even again, on a subconscious level, it's nothing conscious, but, you know, I mean, I remember there's a Superman shot in Man of Steel, which I loved. And so when I was shooting Superman on Justice League, I'm sure that in my head, somewhere in the back of my head, that scene from Man of Steel played. And I was like, oh, you know, cool. I could do something like that. You know, that would be really cool because there could be a similarity there. But I wouldn't sit there and go like, have a printout of Man of Steel and be like, oh, I need to copy exactly this shot.
That makes sense.
No, a lot of this, I think a lot of this plays, at least for me, I'm sure it's the same for a lot of people, at least for me, it a lot of this stuff is much more on an emotional level rather than like a technological level or It's much more emotional, so it's much more internal, you know.
I actually find out about you, there was, I think you were in New, correct me if I'm wrong, I think you were in New York and you did an interview. I think it was about the Snyder Cut. Landitis, I think he was there. But I know Larry Funk thinks highly of you. I did ask Larry, you know, because there was a whole big debate on Twitter a couple of months ago. There's a lot of people that prefers pineapple on their pizza. So I wanted to know do you prefer pineapples on your pizza or pepperoni? I mean, that was a whole big debate that actually Zack Snyder started. There are people who are pro pineapple on pizza. There are people who are not a big fan of pineapple pizza. So we want to know, where does Mr. Fabian Wagner stand in the pineapple on the pizza? Are you pro or are you against pineapple on pizza?
I would not put pineapple on pizza at home if I was making myself a pizza, let's put it that way. But if you give me a pizza at 3 o'clock in the morning after a night out and I'm really hungry and it's got pineapples on it, I'm not going to complain.
Okay, but it's not something that I mean, because to me, if I want real pizza, I don't put pineapple pizza. Now, if I'm ordering Domino's, like my wife, she likes the thin crust. My two daughters and my wife, they like the thin crust of Domino's, pineapple and pepperoni. But if I'm going to like a pizzeria shop, I want true cheesy pizza is what I want. So now we know Mr. Fabio Wagner, he will only eat pineapple on the pizza if it's probably the last thing on earth. Other than that, in the morning. Yeah. So, Tony, nice to see you. Nerdy, many ways. Thank you. The big shout out. Fabio, I actually have a friend who does a little bit what you do. And I started asking him a question because I told him I was going to have you on my show, and he takes pictures. And he told me the key are the angles and the lenses. I have no idea what that means. He told me that you will know what lenses mean. So explain to the audience, how important are the lenses for someone in your profession?
Well, that is a tricky question because there's so many different lenses and they all do something different. They all have different technical aspects, they all look slightly differently. Some are cooler, some are warmer, some have horizontal flares, some have no flares, some are soft on the corner, some are soft in the middle, some are straight, some are bended. I mean, this is like the whole, you know, there's a lot of different lenses out there. Lenses are a whole, it's one of the things of this job that before you start something, you kind of have an idea in your head of what the movie or the TV show should look like. It gives you a certain style of lenses that could be possible, and then really it's down to testing. So you would take all of those lenses that you're thinking of that might be right, and you would have a couple of days and you would test them, and you would shoot certain scenes with actors or without actors, and light them and try out what those lenses do and how they look like and see which one is the right one. So lenses are very important, yes. But in the end, a good movie, all you need for a good movie is you need a camera and you need a couple of really good actors and a good script. That's all you need. So in the end, it doesn't matter what lenses are on there, because that's all it takes for a good film.
He's practically every Christmas he asks his wife for a lenses that cost $13,000, and I had no idea that lenses cost that much. And another friend told him the taking a picture on the phone is the same thing as taking it on the camera, and he looked at him like, don't you dare say that to me. So he takes some beautiful pictures. I mean, he took a picture of Puerto Rico in the sky. He took a picture of animals. Right now he's in the Everglades in Miami, taking pictures. So I hope he does well. So Ali, go ahead. I don't want to, you know, I know it's your turn now.
Oh no, it's fine. I'm listening to the conversation. So I'm I would imagine, I guess, that each film you work on and, you know, different cast, different crews, different directors. Oh, you muted me.
There we go. No, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Okay. I'm sure with, you know, each project, there's maybe something that kind of sticks with you from that experience. Or like, okay. We weren't able to hear the answer.
Can you hear me?
Yes. We can hear you.
Okay, go ahead. Go ahead, Ali.
So did you have a specific experience or a specific moment or something that stuck with you after working on Justice League that carries with you now?
Yeah, just the whole, everything about Justice League was a special experience to me. You know, every time you do a film, you learn something. But working with Zach, I don't think I've ever learned as much as I have working with Zach. You know, he, like I said, he's a super visual director. He's very creative. He's also just a super nice human being. He's very collaborative. And so, yes, I've taken away a lot of positive experiences from working with him.
Fabian, without telling us, do you have, because obviously we know you're under NDA, do you have an idea when we're going to see Zach's film?
Unfortunately, I have no idea.
Okay, sorry guys, I try. what do you have a next project after Justice League? Is there something that you're working on that we don't know about?
There's something I'm working on currently which you don't know about because it's not official yet, but it's an exciting one. And
when will we know?
I'm not sure when they're gonna. I don't know when they're gonna announce it, but can't be that long.
Okay. All right. So is it with Zach or you can't say?
I can't say.
Okay. I try. Okay. And we have about 10 minutes left with Fabian. So we're going to wind this down with Fabian. Then I'm going to stay on with Ali a little bit. Ali, is there any questions? Because you're asking some great questions. I'm really impressed. You actually complete me. Make the show.
I'm a little nervous. This is like my first like real interview with someone.
Really?
Awesome. Yeah. I'm just wondering when the Snyder Cut comes out, or I guess in general, anyways, any projects that you work on, when they're released, are you watching them as a fan or are you watching them like, you know what I mean? From your professional, like, are you nitpicking your own stuff or are you watching it like just to enjoy it as a fan?
You know, I just, like I said early on, I just love movies, you know, I watch anything, everything, all the time. I always love watching movies. So, no, I wouldn't, you know, I'm definitely not nitpicking. I wouldn't, you know, like, I've always been a Game of Thrones fan before I did Game of Thrones, and I watched it till the end, even though, you know, it's a little bit different once, when you've shot it, you know what happens. So, it's a kind of a different viewing experience. But, you know, no, I still watch it, you know.
Who is your favorite DC character? I think that some of the fans or somebody asked me that they want to know from you. Who is your favorite DC character if you have one?
Well, my personal one is Batman, purely because I've always loved Batman when I was a kid. You know, he was always my favorite character as a kid. I loved the Batman movies, you know, the early Tim Burton stuff. So, you know, he would be my top one. But you know, he kind of enjoy all of them, really.
Okay, go ahead, Ali.
Oh, you put me on the spot. I wasn't ready for another question. Is it different though? Well, is it kind of surreal to see them though, like in front of you in these beautiful costumes? Like, are you still kind of thinking them? Are you thinking of them as, well, I know when you're shooting, you're gonna have to think of them as like the character, but is it kind of like going back and forth between when you're not shooting and you're just hanging out on set? Is it like a weird, like visually you're like, wow, that really looks like a Superman or a Batman out of the comics, but this, they're in front of me now. Like, is it just a, I don't know. Is it?
No. I mean, look, I mean, shooting, you know, shooting with them was great, you know, just to be on the set. I mean, my favorite day was the, you know, the the rooftop scene when Gordon switches on the bat light, you know, that was like such an awesome thing to shoot the bat light, you know, and Batman up on the gargoyles, and you know, that was such a cool day. So you know, I remember standing there thinking, man, this is like awesome. I can't believe that I'm here shooting that, you know. So, you know, it's slightly different when you're getting a coffee and there's Henry Cavill in his Superman costume standing there having a cup of tea, you know, you're a bit like, oh.
Yeah, we're used to that around here.
but no, it's great. You know, it's just yeah, the costumes. And the costumes, you know, Michael's costumes are amazing. You know, the costumes look incredible. So
yes, even when they're not, just when you see random set pictures, they're like, wow, they still look amazing. Like, mm-hmm. not just in the movie in this high definition quality, but like just random set pictures that even like ones that you've shared a lot of on social media, like they just look awesome, and that's just a regular picture. So yep. I could imagine in person how that would look.
Have you shot any additional pictures for the Snyder Cut of Fabian?
Zach has been shooting I think it was roughly 4 minutes of additional stuff.
Okay.
I didn't travel. I'm in England right now, and I didn't travel to LA because of COVID, obviously, and the whole situation going on in the world. Right. So I didn't do those, but yeah, they were shooting that.
Okay.
They only did like a couple of days of shooting, I think.
Okay. And my personal favorite is, as you probably know by the background, is Superman. So I could relate more to Superman. Now, if you ask my wife, she likes both
Before
Batman
we
and Superman.
Let you go.
So I asked her, you can only choose one. She says, like, no,
thank you so much,
both of them. And I asked her why. She said, well, if I'm in trouble, I want Superman to save me. And Bruce Wayne is the billionaire. I could go shopping all the time. So there you go. So she likes Batman versus Superman. But to wind it down,
social media. But
when you think about in general what
Thank you for, you know,
you were in 2017, obviously, you know, setting
like
aside for the COVID-19, because obviously, you know, the whole world changed.
Calling for something,
but from that
happen,
point forward, did
like
you ever think that you would see this day, that we would actually see, not just
so
your hard work,
just,
but Zach's hard
like
work
were
play out
and other people that
in
on
the
movie,
public see it? Did you ever think that we would see that movie?
This was a thing, you know, I think that just helped us stay motivated.
That would ever happen.
Keep doing, you know, all these
really
crazy things, flying the airplanes and, you know, getting the Times Square billboard and all this stuff and making videos or whatever it is, you know. So I just want to say thank you for helping us in that way. And like you have said, like, yeah, the fans brought this.
Thank you. Thank you to all of you guys.
Thank you We can't wait to see your beautiful work. So.
Yes,
I'm happy for you and Zach and everyone that just gets to share this with us finally. So,
and Tony wants to know, Fabian, are you looking forward towards Matt Reeves' new Batman?
Thank you very much.
I'm pretty sure Fabian is. He said in the beginning of the show he likes watching movies. I'm pretty sure. I'm pretty sure Fabian is going
to
be.
I'm very looking forward to it.
Okay. Well, Fambi, I want to thank you so much for really, really joining me. You took an hour of your time to talk to us, to let us get to know about you. Obviously, guys, there's certain questions I could not ask because, you know, obviously, even if he didn't know, he can't tell us anyway, so I don't want to put him on the spot. I did try, you know, towards the end about, you know, what project and all that stuff, so... We'll find out soon enough, guys. So, Fabian, thank you so much for really, really joining us. And hopefully we could do this again next year after the Snyder Cut is released, okay?
We'll do it again when the Snyder Cut's out. Thank you, guys. Thanks for all your help and support. And stay safe. And sorry for messing you around with the timing.
No, don't worry about it. No, I appreciate you coming on. So you don't apologize. You don't apologize for that. You have no idea how big it is for me and for Ali. So it's a pleasure to speak with you, and we will always work around your schedule. So no worries.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Take care, guys.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Stay safe.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.